Good afternoon and welcome to today's webinar, Addressing Socioeconomic Barriers to Health Equity Through Law, a preview of the 2018 Public Health Law Conference, brought to you by the Network for Public Health Law and the American Society of Law, Medicine, and Ethics. I'm Charles Strong, the Digital Marketing Coordinator at the Network for Public Health Law's National Office, and I will be your host for today's webinar. Please feel free to submit questions at any time during this webinar by using the Q&A tab on the right-hand side of your screen. All you need to do is click on that tab, select All Panelists from the Ask drop-down menu, and submit your question. Your moderator for today's webinar is Melissa Sager. Melissa is a senior staff attorney at the Network for Public Health Law's Eastern Region Office and at the Legal Resource Center for Public Health Policy. In both of these roles, she provides legal assistance to state and local legislators, health officials, and non-government organizations. Melissa will be leading us through the rest of today's webinar. So, Melissa, over to you.
Thanks, Charles. This is Melissa, and I'm going to introduce you to our three presenters today, and then I'll go through the Q&A at the end. So, first up, we have Russell McCord. Russell McCord is an ORISE Fellow with the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention's Child Development Studies Team, situated in the National Center on Birth Defects and Developmental Disabilities. Russell works in collaboration with the CDC's Public Health Law Program and CDS to apply legal epidemiological methods to public health problems involving children's mental health. His current projects include working to analyze policy levers to improve access to treatment for children with mental and behavioral health disabilities, telemedicine, and supplemental security income. Russell received his undergraduate degree from Vanderbilt University and his JD from Georgia State University College of Law. Next up, we'll have Colin Healy Bufides. And she's a senior attorney with the Network for Public Health Law Mid-States Region, located at the University of Michigan School of Public Health. She assists public health attorneys, practitioners, and advocates to use law to protect the public's health by providing technical assistance, training, and practical tools. Colleen received her law degree from Duke University School of Law and her Bachelor of Science degree from Arizona State University, where she studied psychology and global health. Prior to joining the network, Colleen worked on state and federal legislative and administrative advocacy on behalf of Michigan's federally qualified health centers and as a commercial litigation associate for a large Michigan-based law firm. She also interned with a medical legal partnership as a law student. And then we'll have Sarah Somers, and she is a managing attorney of the National Health Law Program's North Carolina office. She specializes in litigation and litigation support intended to advance access to quality health care for low-income and other underserved people. Working with health and poverty law advocates across the country, she engages in litigation, research, writing, and training on the Medicaid program, the Americans with Disabilities Act, and the Affordable Care Act, among other issues. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Russell to start his presentation.
Thanks, Melissa. As she said, my name is Russell McCord, and I'm a public health law fellow with the Child Development Studies team at CDC. And I'm really happy to give you guys a sneak peek at our presentation that my colleagues, Dawn Pepin and Rachel Holkauer, will be giving as part of a panel at the Public Health Law Conference this year. And as you can see, our title is 50 State Legal Epidemiology Assessment of State Telehealth Laws, and we'll get into what all that means in just a little bit. First, I have to start with my mandated disclaimer. I'll be discussing laws today, and I am a lawyer, but unfortunately I'm not your lawyer, and I'm not giving any legal advice. Also, all of this material is preliminary, and it's unpublished, so it does not represent the views of CDC or the government. And now that that's out of the way, I'd also like to thank and acknowledge the other members of our panel who will be joining us at the Public Health Law Conference in a few months. And obviously, I'm not an expert on their material, and I won't presume to do it justice, but you should absolutely come hear them speak and share their expertise at the conference. So these next few slides are from our colleague, Brittany Bowerly. And as you can see, we start with defining what is telehealth. And these are extremely big topics, even for something as seemingly simple as defining the terms. There are a few generally accepted definitions from organizations like WHO or Center for Connected Health Policy, but states are not necessarily obligated to follow these definitions, and as I'll allude to later, sometimes they don't. But it's important to understand where we're starting, where the background is for all this research. So one of the key issues in telehealth and telemedicine is access. And so that means there needs to be infrastructure and technological capabilities to deliver these services through the medium of telehealth. And expanding broadband is one of these issues. Brittany will highlight it at the conference, but lack of access to broadband is an issue for a huge portion of Americans, especially in rural areas. As you can see there, 34 million people in 2016 lacked broadband access. So if the idea is to get telemedicine to people who can't otherwise access services, but if they don't have the technological capabilities, then this isn't really serving them. So finally, the last teaser for Brittany's part of the panel, these are some helpful examples of telehealth modalities that are already in use out in the field. And some of these might be familiar to you. This list shows some of the range of the types of services that can be delivered via telemedicine, from TB monitoring to substance use treatments, and even as far as professionals consulting and connecting via something like Project Echo. So there's a lot of different ways telehealth broadly can be applied. All right, and now I'll just briefly, before I jump into the meat of our project, I'd like to highlight what our role at CDC is through the Public Health Law Program. And I'm sure everyone knows CDC is a non-regulatory agency, and that means we can't make regulations and we can't give policy recommendations or lobby or anything like that. But what we can do is provide data on what laws are in place and if we have enough data on how those laws relate to public health outcomes. So we want to make law understandable and highlight how it can be a useful tool to improve public health. We provide the data, strive to make it useful for our state, local, and tribal partners, both in and out of government, so that they can make the laws that they want or advocate for the changes they want to see to achieve those improved public health outcomes. And as you can definitely visit our website to learn more about the variety of our different kinds of work that we have going on, and if you ever have any questions or you need technical assistance, definitely feel free to reach out. So as everyone here is aware, telehealth and telemedicine are rapidly growing areas of practice and of law. And at CDC, we kept hearing about these barriers and difficulty, uneasiness about the relationship between the practice of telemedicine and the laws that govern it. So we envisioned this project where we wanted to collect, categorize, and document all of the telehealth laws in the United States, to make an accessible legal data set for further areas of study. These are just some more examples of additional telehealth definitions that we relied on during our background research. This is a little repetitive from the Brittany slide earlier, but you'll note similarities to the Centers for Connected Health Policy definition and the WHO definition, and just really how broad this topic area is. And I'll get into that in just a second. We also wanted to highlight several of the potential benefits of telemedicine that are in the literature. And so we really want to understand how the law is affecting the realization of these benefits. Is the law working to increase access to care? Is it actually increasing efficiency, or is the law hindering that? And whether potential increases in quality of care or decreased costs are actually being realized. So this slide shows how we organized our study. And we're currently in phase one, which is the middle line of that graphic. But we really wanted to create a two-tiered analysis. And so in phase one, which is what we're currently working on, we want to identify all relevant legal provisions that deal with telehealth. And so literally everything. It doesn't matter whether it's an insurance law or a licensure law or the board can make rules governing telehealth, dictating an office, anything like that. We wanted to capture it all. And then we want to organize it in such a way that it can be studied by either by us or by anyone to figure out specifics of the laws that affect them. So we use the standardized search string, which is really long and expansive, and if you'd like it, feel free to reach out. But we collected all statutes and regulations in effect as of July 1st, 2017, containing any reference to telehealth, telemedicine, or any profession specifically labeled as tele-X. So this could be teledentistry or telepsychology, telepsychiatry, anything like that, anything you can think of. We found a lot. And all our jurisdictions included U.S. states, the District of Columbia, Puerto Rico, the U.S. Virgin Islands, and territories such as Guam, Northern Mariana Islands, and anything that was within the Westlaw legal database. So based on our literature review, we developed 20 coding categories, which you'll see in a little bit, that pertain to both legal and public health topics that are addressed in these laws. And so using our broad search string, we found over 2,200 statutes and regulations within the 50 states, DC, Puerto Rico, US Virgin Islands, and Guam. And then we're almost finished categorizing them by the nature of the telehealth use described in the law. And I'll just note that we did not find any relevant laws for the Northern Mariana Islands. So this slide is just a quick list of the topics that we figured might be interesting. And so we developed our coding scheme to capture both these public health and legal topics. And we coded each provision individually, so a single law could have multiple tags. For example, if it was from the insurance code, it provided a definition of telemedicine, and it also required reimbursement for behavioral health services delivered over telemedicine. We would give that an insurance tag, a definitions tag, and a mental health tag. And then we did this for each law. It was coded twice independently by two of the three of us, with the third attorney being the arbiter for any discrepancies. And we had regular coding meetings to resolve any discrepancies and come to agreement, with the third attorney having final decision-making power. So now I'll get into a little bit of the preliminary results. I'm gonna keep any specific breakdowns, maps, or numbers. I'm gonna keep those from you for now, but we anticipate having those available at the actual presentation in October, so definitely come if this is interesting to you, and we hope to provide some interesting analysis. But of our preliminary results, all 50 states, DC and Puerto Rico, the US Virgin Islands and Guam, all had at least one law governing telehealth. And the numbers and the types of laws varied a lot, as you probably would imagine. Some states had as few as 7 telehealth laws, and some states had as many as, I think the most was like 175. So states definitely differed in their approach to telemedicine. And jurisdictions used law to do such things as designate a rural health office to oversee their telehealth program. We saw several on establishing pilots or funding for telehealth training and treatment programs. We saw establishment of reimbursement requirements for both Medicaid and private insurance. And that's an active area of study for people inside and outside of CDC. So we saw a lot of standards for telehealth training and practice, so requirements on providers, once they have the requisite licensure and all that, how they actually have to conduct themselves with regard to protecting patient data and all types of things like that. And additionally, we saw several provisions about facilitating broadband procurement. So these were not necessarily directed at providers, but more at facilities and the types of internet or video audio technology that were required before you could engage in telemedicine. So this is just a snippet and a citation for one of those designation of office that we saw from North Carolina, and it dictated that the Office of Rural Health was to oversee and monitor the establishment and administration of a statewide telepsychiatry program. And these weren't necessarily always specific to telepsychiatry. It could be for almost anything. We saw telestroke, teledentistry, lots of different profession-specific provisions. So we also saw several that tried to set up specific telehealth programs. For example, you can see these two from Nebraska talking about oral health care which they envisioned could you could provide training and education via telehealth, since it's a health health-related practice. Even though it's oral health, you're not going to brush your teeth over the phone, but you can see how it relates. And then also, it's always important to fund these types of programs. So we saw several provisions that either provided explicit funding or they provided a test case, a group of funds for a pilot or a demonstration. Another very broad topic was established who can be reimbursed under Medicaid, and this is just a snippet from Mississippi showing that the Division of Medicaid reimburses the originating site, and that's a big one, reimburses the originating site, the Mississippi Medicaid telehealth originating site facility fee for telehealth services per completed transmission. And that's not super exciting, but you can see like there's a lot of terms in there that it's important to understand. So we also highlighted what an originating site means. We filed those under location. So we have an you could pull out an entire subset of these laws that deal with what an originating site is, what a receiving site is, those type of things. And finally, this is just a snippet about a law that facilitates broadband procurement. This is in Nevada. And you can see there the states are anticipating that if telemedicine is going to do all the things that we want it to do, it's going to be important to expand broadband service to the areas that you want to reach. So finally, where do we go after all of this? Our goal has always been to eventually transition to that last, that bottom line there of phase two projects. And so what that means is, for example, my team's focus at the Child Development Studies team is on children's mental health. So I would like to pull the subset of telehealth laws pertaining to mental health and then dig into those to see how they affect children, the types of services that are anticipated by the laws, and anything that affects the access or increasing access via cost reductions, reimbursement, parity, or anything else I can find. Some preliminary things we looked at is the timing of service. Do states only allow children receiving telemental health treatment to have active, interactive, real-time audiovisual, or can you submit video to a doctor and have it reviewed later, which is typically called store and forward? So there's a whole lot of issues that you can dig into for specific topic areas. Similarly, Dawn and Rachel have their portfolios, and they've already envisioned a few follow-up projects pertaining to rural health or data protections or health equity. There's just a few. And also, this data set will be public, so anyone else can design studies to pull subsets of whatever types of laws they're interested in, either with our collaboration or not. And we also plan to keep this data set updated. We already know that new laws and regulations have gone into effect since we started back in July of 2017. So one of the ongoing projects will be to keep our data set updated and to keep these laws categorized, because it's always changing. All right, I appreciate the opportunity to share this with you guys, and we hope to see you all at our panel in October. If you have any comments or questions about this work or any of our other work or PHLP in general, definitely feel free to contact us. And I will pass it now to Colleen.
Thanks, Russell. Hi, everyone. I am excited to share a preview today of our public health law conference session on working with medical legal partnerships to address social determinants of health. The network has been collaborating with the National Center for Medical Legal Partnership and with individual MLPs, medical legal partnerships across the country for the past year or so on this topic, and I'm really excited about the opportunities for large-scale public health legal improvements when MLPs and public health attorneys and practitioners work together, and that's a lot of what we'll focus on in October. So today, I'll start with a few minutes about how the medical legal partnership model works, and then I will talk about how MLPs can play a really unique and important role in public health legal change. Then I'll wrap up by telling you about the network's collaboration with the National Center for Medical Legal Partnership and MLPs. So I have a few slides here from the National Center for Medical Legal Partnership, who will be joining us in October. And these give a quick overview of the medical legal partnership model. So the model brings legal and healthcare professionals together by embedding lawyers as members of the healthcare team. And then they work together to address social and environmental factors contributing to individual patients' health problems. The attorney helps to identify and resolve individual health-harming legal problems, sometimes through legal representation or through brief advice, and then also might consult with clinical and non-clinical staff to help them understand health-harming legal needs and to think about ways to improve institutional policies or practices within the clinic to help overcome barriers. So one example of that is from Lancaster General Hospital in Pennsylvania, where an MLP attorneys developed a template letter for physicians to use to document medical need to help prevent utility shutoffs for patients with chronic diseases. And then they added this template letter to the electronic health record so that it would be easily accessible to physicians when needed by their patients. In other contexts, attorneys consult with social workers or community health workers or case managers or other members of the healthcare team to help them to assist patients with common legal challenges and then step in as needed to assist with more complex problems. And then increasingly, MLPs leverage their patient-level expertise and experiences to advance local and state policy change. And this is a lot of where we'll focus today, on the opportunity for MLPs to scale their efforts by working with public health professionals and attorneys to seek broader legal changes. So the National Center for Medical Legal Partnership uses this acronym IHELP to categorize the social determinants of health that MLPs primarily work on. The specific focus areas definitely depend on the MLP, and most do not work in all of these issues, but in one or more of these areas. So the National Center refers to these as health-harming legal needs. The first one is income and insurance, which includes making sure that clients have access to the benefits that they're entitled to. Housing and utilities includes helping to prevent evictions, foreclosures, and utility shutoffs, and enforcing housing codes to make sure that homes are habitable and safe. Education and employment includes making sure that kids get the services they need in public schools and that adults with disabilities get the accommodations they need in the workplace. Legal status encompasses a lot of different issues, including immigration status, and helping people with convictions pursue expungement of a criminal record. And then personal and family stability is that last category, and that includes helping to obtain protective orders for individuals facing domestic violence, seeking guardianship when necessary for children or adults or other issues like that. The MLP movement has grown a lot in recent years, with MLPs now located at 333 healthcare organizations across the country. And some of those involve state or local public health departments, including MLPs that partner with the Delaware Division of Public Health, the City of Chicago Public Health Department, and the Los Angeles County Health Department. And finally, studies show that MLPs have a huge impact on patients' health and on health systems. So they help to reduce hospital admissions for people with chronic diseases, they increase patient compliance with prescribed medications, and they reduce patient stress. And by ensuring that patients are enrolled in and receiving health insurance benefits that they're entitled to, MLPs have also been able to increase reimbursement for healthcare systems and decrease costs to patients. One of the really key changes that the MLP model achieves is that it creates a type of primary care in the legal world. Legal aid is generally so underfunded that they are often able to provide only emergency legal care and don't have the resources to provide preventive legal care. So for example, they're so overwhelmed by helping people who are facing evictions that they have less time available to help identify the other legal issues that might contribute to the person's persistent financial problems, such as unlawful garnishment of wages or wrongful denial of public benefits. National studies have suggested that only about 20% of the legal needs of low-income people are addressed with assistance from an attorney, which leaves 80% of their legal needs unmet. MLPs take a step towards closing that gap by leveraging different funding sources to support MLP attorneys, and by placing lawyers in a position to train other healthcare staff to help patients navigate legal issues. So the MLP model helps to move a step upstream, focusing more on preventive legal care rather than emergency legal care. And this leads us to the question of how we can move even further upstream to ask how MLPs can contribute to and lead public health legal changes that will lead to population level improvements. In public health contexts, we often look at Thomas Friedman's health impact pyramid or other models like that to think about levels of prevention. So now that we've moved from emergency care to preventive care in the legal context, what would it look like to move from the very involved individual level prevention associated with individual legal services to a more population-focused prevention strategy? I'm guessing that most of you on this webinar are very familiar already with the difference between a healthcare and a public health approach to preventing disease. The traditional healthcare approach is very similar to the traditional legal approach, legal aid approach, in terms of being a more individualist model. In terms of healthcare, it generally focuses on preventing disease in individual patients through secondary and tertiary prevention strategies, such as early screening and detection and individual interventions to help mitigate symptoms. And in contrast, the public health approach focuses on the population instead of individuals and emphasizes primary prevention strategies. So looking at going back to the health impact pyramid, we see that the prevention strategies that public health more often focuses are those ones on the bottom level that have the greater impact on the population as a whole. So if you compare those public health actions with legal actions for preventing poor health, I think you can come up with a pretty similar looking pyramid that can give us some ideas for collaboration. So there's individual representation and counseling and education at the top, which both require significant effort by the attorney and the client. And then as you move towards population-focused strategies, we might see impact litigation, which is strategic litigation that's aimed to establish useful precedents. And maybe you would see changes to health system and government system practices. And then just like in the public health action, the health impact pyramid, you'd arrive at socioeconomic factors at the bottom as the strategy that's most likely to have the greatest population level impact. And I think that's where the two pyramids are the same and where there's a really great opportunity to work together. Public health practitioners and MLPs are both focused on addressing those socioeconomic factors in order to prevent health problems from occurring, and law is one of the most effective tools for doing that. So in thinking about how law affects socioeconomic factors, I think it's helpful to think about two pathways. Professor Scott Burris has described these pathways as the law of the books, which is the law as written, and the law of the streets, which is the law as applied. And even where a law is well written and seems like it should improve health, it may not be effective if it's differently interpreted or enforced, and that may depend on the jurisdiction or population. And this is why the law of the streets might turn out to be different than the law of the books. The field of legal epidemiology, which is what Russell was just talking about, has emerged as a way to study how the law of the books affects health. Researchers examine a set of written laws and then look at how they affect health in a given area. But it can be hard to know what the law of the streets is and how it's affecting health unless you're right there on the ground with it. And that's exactly where MLPs are. They are on the ground working with clients who are experiencing legal challenges and facing health problems as a result. So they have a really unique insight into the law of the streets. So to think through the specific opportunities for MLPs to play a role in larger public health law efforts, I'm going to use the five essential public health law services framework, which describes the five core legal services needed to develop and widely disseminate effective legal solutions. The framework was developed to flesh out the two law-related components of the 10 public health law services, which are enforce laws and develop policies. And it was developed based on past successes in the field of public health law, such as with auto safety laws and tobacco control. The services are shown here in a linear sequence. The process of legal change is often nonlinear and iterative, and so these may not occur in this order, but each of the services is necessary to achieving and then disseminating legal solutions. And a really important component of this framework also is that shown in that arrow at the bottom, which indicates that health equity is a central driver for each service and for the framework as a whole. And it's important to consider how the law differently affects different populations. So here is a quick summary of each service. The first is access to evidence and expertise. This involves identifying problems based on evidence and determining what needs to be done. Designing legal solutions involves looking at what is the best way to use the law to do this. Engaging communities and building political will includes educating and mobilizing communities to get a good idea into law. And implementing, enforcing, and defending legal solutions involves ensuring capacity and accountability for implementation and defense of laws. And then policy, surveillance, and evaluation assesses the impact of the legal solution and then spreads those that work. And all of these involve many different disciplines. And so these involve lawyers, but they involve many other partners in the community. And MLPs are one of the many important partners that can play a really important role. So when, in specifically thinking about that role that MLPs can play, with respect to the first service, which is about building good policy ideas, MLPs can contribute their on-the-ground experience that is really unique for providing input into how and why existing laws are not working for their clients. And they have evidence of both the legal challenges and the health consequences. For the second service, designing legal solutions, this is about finding the strongest legal approach, and MLP teams are really key here because they can assist with anticipating unintended consequences or enforcement challenges associated with a given approach based on their experience seeing these things happen in other contexts. And then they can help with proactively figuring out how to avoid those challenges in the legal design. This third service is about getting good ideas into law by engaging communities and building political will to support the law. A transdisciplinary MLP team that includes health practitioners, lawyers, patients and clients, and all of those different communities that those people are involved in can help to spread information about the idea, help to educate the public and educate policymakers, and it can help to base that in real-time, real-life experiences. This fourth service is about implementation, and here MLP lawyers can share valuable information and experience from their from the front lines of patient and client advocacy, and they can help to inform strategies to implement and enforce laws. They can proactively file complaints to press for enforcement or to enforce the requirements against private parties on behalf of their clients, and they can assist or challenge government enforcement agencies. And then finally, in the fifth service, this is about learning and diffusing what works, and MLP partners can play a really important role here in identifying what are the unintended consequences or unanticipated successes of the law and helping to point out where there are gaps in the law that might have been overlooked. And so this is really key to making sure that the laws that spread are good ones. So I'll wrap up today with a quick description of the collaboration between the Network for Public Health Law, the National Center for Medical Legal Partnership, and individual MLPs across the country, which has been focused on identifying effective ways to collaborate. So we launched this project with a few ideas in mind for how we could collaborate. One was to work together to identify systemic health-harming legal issues that are ripe for public health legal intervention, and this is especially based on the on-the-ground experiences of MLPs and what they're seeing in terms of repeat issues from their clients. The second is for the network to provide technical assistance to MLPs to increase their capacity to scale current individual and community level efforts to achieve population level impact. And then the third is to work together to support state and local health department involvement in MLPs, whether as formal members of the partnership or as informal partners with shared goals. So we approach these goals by pairing network regions with MLPs in the same region, and then in each, for each team, they work together to identify legal barriers emerging as patterns within the populations they're serving, and then try to increase capacity to address those issues by collaborating around shared priorities. So here's an example of how this looked for one of the teams. We started by meeting regularly to identify issues of overlapping priority and expertise, and kind of zeroed in on lead poisoning and housing conditions as an issue where all of the team members were working. The MLPs identified low rates of childhood lead screening as a significant barrier to tackling the lead poisoning issues in their communities, because in the absence of complete screening data, they were finding it difficult to understand the full scope and nature of the lead poisoning problem, but knew based on anecdotal evidence that it was a really significant issue in their communities. So the team developed an outline for a memorandum together that could be shared with community partners to define the problem, outline existing legal screening requirements and barriers to screening, and then discuss a range of legal and non-legal strategies to improve lead screening rates. And that memo is currently being finalized and has already been disseminated to some stakeholders in its early form. And then broader dissemination is planned following completion. And hopefully that will help to inform some local next steps. So I will be joined by Joel Teitelbaum with the National Center for Medical Legal Partnership, Dennis Shia with the Los Angeles Department of Health Services and UCLA Medical Center, and Elise Citrini with LAF Chicago at the Public Health Law Conference in October. These panelists have all been involved in the collaboration and will share some of their experiences and reflections on how MLPs can help to address the social determinants of health on a population level. So I hope you all can join us there. Thank you. And I'll pass it over to Sarah.
Thank you, Colleen. So I'm going to talk about my session at the conference. And the conference is, at the conference, I'm going to focus on another project that we're doing with the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. And this is a project about integrating clinical and community health using Medicaid's child health benefit. So first I'll tell you a bit about the project, and then I will give you the background on Medicaid and the coverage of services for children that lend themselves to this project. So the project is, the goal of it is to promote implementation and understanding of Medicaid's EPSDT benefit. And if you don't know what that is, I will be telling you about it in a minute. We want to promote cross-sector understanding of the role in the social safety net. So as part of that, we have engaged organizations in three southeastern states, North Carolina, South Carolina, and Virginia, and with them, and a group of diverse stakeholders, they will develop action plans to improve child health. This is a two-year project, and we're about 14 months into it. In addition, at the same time, we engage national experts in safety net and civil rights programs, housing and food and nutrition security, education, environmental, disability, and consumer. And we created what we're calling a federal legal safety net scan. And it's a compendium of laws that govern, for example, the food stamps program, the cash assistance program that protect consumers from, through consumer law protections, that protect disability rights and prevent civil rights discrimination. And that has been completed, and we're still working on getting that into a more digestible, not completely lawyerish form. And finally, we have ongoing efforts to educate the state stakeholders on the EPSDT benefit in their state. So our state partner organizations are three fabulous advocacy organizations, the North Carolina Justice Center in Raleigh, North Carolina, the South Carolina Appleseed Legal Justice Center in Columbia, and then the Virginia Poverty Law Center in Richmond. And through them, we are working with a diverse group of stakeholders who are based at the state level. some of them are the usual suspects. They include physicians, they include people from the state Medicaid agencies, as well as those that work explicitly on child health. But to focus on the social determinants and to go outside of just the clinical world, there's also partnerships with housing organizations, with civil rights organizations, with schools, and with faith-based and local governments. There have been two stakeholder convenings in each state, and then the state advocates are continuing to work with sort of a super stakeholder group of those who are more involved with it. And we're in the process of working with data to identify the child health indicators that we're going to be targeting for improvement. So ultimately, what we will have at the end of this project is the federal safety net scan of benefits and rights, state-specific benefits and rights mapped out, training materials on EPSDT, and then a blueprint for child health improvement that can be implemented at the state level. So what is EPSDT? I'm sure you're just beyond in suspense now, so I will get with it and tell you about it. For those of you who aren't well-versed in Medicaid, this is just a review of the basics. Medicaid is currently an entitlement. It's prescribed by federal and state law, and if you are in a state and you meet that state's eligibility criteria, then you qualify. There are no, there should not be waiting lists or limitations based on state funding. Medicaid prescribes at the federal level that certain population groups must be covered. Since we're talking about child health, that includes children below certain levels of the poverty level, depending on age, most foster and adopted children, pregnant women, and then children with disabilities. There are covered services. Some must be covered, like hospital or physician services. And then there are optional services. A lot of behavioral health services are optional, physical therapy, occupational therapy. And because it's an entitlement, there are rights to notice and an opportunity for hearing if eligibility or services are denied, terminated, suspended, or reduced. I have a little asterisk there because the fact entitlement is something that is becomes a dirty word in some political circles. And there is a movement afoot at the administration to allow states to circumscribe Medicaid and limit it in ways that they haven't been able to before. So watch this space. EPSDT. It stands for Early Periodic Screening, Diagnostic, and Treatment. This is not the most transparent or useful acronym, but it's the one we have at the federal level. In your state, the EPSDT program might be known as Baby Love or Health Check, or something like that, something a little bit more colloquial and a little bit more user-friendly. EPSDT was originated not long after Medicaid was enacted in the mid-1960s. And the impetus for it was a recognition that because of their low income, poor children are much more vulnerable to all the typical problems that children face, including some that are really the byproduct of poverty. All of the problems that that are listed there, plus others, are much more pronounced in poor children. And that's because of the environment they live in, the shortage of food, the lack of safety, noise pollution, being deprived of parental support because of a lack of childcare or problems in schools. Everything you want to know and more about EPSDT is in this guide. This is a federal guide that was put together in about 2013-2014. And it's a compendium of all of the guidance about EPSDT. And what you will come away with when you look at this is how broad EPSDT is. Medicaid for adults is not unlike private insurance in that you get a card or an authorization number, and they say, okay, adult, here are the services that are covered, here are the limitations, go find providers that will accept it. Now, for children, the rules are different. EPSDT means that children must get proactive screening at certain intervals, that the state has to provide treatment that is revealed by, a need for which is revealed by the screens. And regardless of whether a service is designated as mandatory or optional, it must be covered for children if it's medically necessary. This is the mantra of EPSDT, and this is what the guide says. The benefit is more robust than Medicaid for adults. It's designed to assure that children receive early detection and care so that health problems are averted or diagnosed and treated as early as possible. The goal is to assure that individual children get the health care they need when they need it, the right care to the right child at the right time in the right setting. And so this is focusing not only on the services they need, but talking about getting upstream, preventing the problems before they become too severe, and focusing on the environment where the children actually get the services. So EPSDT, this is a breakdown of EPSDT's participation rates. And this is the universe of children we're talking about here are children who are eligible for Medicaid. All children under age 21 who qualify for Medicaid, with some limited exceptions, are entitled to EPSDT. So what they need, what the state's goal is to get every single kid who's enrolled in Medicaid into the EPSDT program. Unfortunately, and make sure that they're screened. Unfortunately, the participation rates vary widely. Nobody's at 100%. Just a few states are up near 90. And a lot of states, there are kids really just falling through the cracks. They may qualify for the program, but they may not be aware of the full scope of benefits, or for whatever reason, they're not getting in the door. And so this is one of the problems that we'd like to try to focus on as a part of the project we're working on. So let's start with the entry point, screening. These screenings sometimes are called well child checkups, but that's a term that should be used carefully because it has prescribed components under federal law and also under the state law. The medical screen has to include specific components, a developmental history, unclothed physical exam, immunizations, lab testing, like for lead blood level, and then age-appropriate health education. I have that in red because that's part of the social determinants of health entry point here. Children and their parents are supposed to be educated about risks and opportunities at the appropriate age. For example, parents of infants are to be warned about the perils of shaking a baby. Small children need to be educated about stranger danger. Older children, the perils of using tobacco. Adolescents, age-appropriate sex education. And those need to be provided not just when they're asked for or when there's a problem, but certain intervals based on their age. Every state has what's called a periodicity schedule, and it's based on recommendations from the American Academy of Pediatrics Bright Futures, which some of you child health mavens will certainly be familiar with. It's not just medical screens, though. It's vision, hearing, and dental screens as well. Not only are they provided at expert-advised periodic intervals, but they have to be provided when needed. And any encounter with a doctor is considered a screen. And that's important because treatment is covered if the need for it is revealed by a screen. So basically, if a kid is enrolled in Medicaid, pursuant to EPSDT, if they're seen by a Medicaid or a non-Medicaid provider, and there is a need for treatment, it needs to be covered. It has to fit within the list of federal benefits. In the statute, there's a list of categories of services, physician services, hospital services, nursing facilities, some of the services that I mentioned earlier. And there's a federal definition of medical necessity. And that definition is services are covered if they're necessary to correct or ameliorate a condition or illness. Ameliorate is a key word here because anybody who's dealt with private insurance or Medicaid for adults, they know that services are not necessarily covered just to maintain someone's functioning or to keep something from getting worse. There usually is a higher standard for what's medically necessary, and this is broader. The EPSDT strategy guide that I showed earlier, that makes it explicit what the feds have said about EPSDT for years. You can't have waiting lists. You can't have hard limits on hours of services. It needs to be keyed to the child's medical necessity. That's not to say the state has no control over it. The state still is responsible for utilization review and still has a responsibility for determining medical necessity. But they don't have as much leeway to limit services as they do for adults. And another important aspect of EPSDT that impacts the social determinants is that it can be provided in other environments. Services can be provided in the school, including through an IEP. They must be provided in the most integrated setting appropriate, which means that children should be served in the community and not in institutions when they can be. Getting children out of big developmental centers and institutions was a movement that took place in the 70s and 80s and is still going on today. And Medicaid has become a very indispensable partner in that push. And finally, EPSDT requires that transportation be provided. Appointment scheduling and assistance is provided as well. So this is a proactive reach into almost the world of case management and social services to make sure that families understand the benefit, that they're aware of the benefit, and that they have access to it. The informing has to be in a variety of methods calculated to reach difficult-to-reach populations. It needs to be oral and written informing, translation and interpretation for people who have limited English proficiency, accessible for people with disabilities, and targeted to really vulnerable populations. So this sounds wonderful, and this law has been on the books for almost as slightly longer than I've been alive, which is a long time, friends, 1965. And that is unfortunate because, as you saw from the participation rates, it's still very low. And so one aspect of the project that we're working on with our state partners in these three states is to make that number go up, that participation grow up, rate go up, the screening go up, and to get children into the program earlier. So another aspect of the program that's not prescribed by statute but has been the subject of federal guidance for years is that states through their EPSDT programs are responsible for coordinating with agencies that interact with children. Maternal and child health agencies, Title V agencies, are specifically mentioned. The WIC program, the Women, Infants, and Children Nutrition Program, Head Start for very young preschool-age children, and then the schools in general. So the more that you find the children where they are and the low-income children where they are, the more likely you are to have an impact as a state. So at our conference in the fall, we'll be talking more about the project. I and the project director, Lee James, who is here at the National Health Law Program, will certainly be there. And we're currently trying to lure some of our state partners out there. They will be able to talk about the particular state stakeholders they've been interacting with, and we'll probably be further along in identifying the child health goals and measures that we're going to be focusing on. So with that, I will hand it back to you, Charles.
Thank you, Sarah. I think now we're going to jump into the Q&A session, and our moderator, Melissa, will be filtering through your questions, so feel free to send us any questions about the three topics that we've discussed today, and Melissa will filter them through and ask our presenters. So over to you, Melissa.
Thanks, Charles. So while I wait, waiting for a few more questions to come in, it looks like the first question is for you, Colleen, about partnering with the network or reaching out to the network for help as people begin to work on FQHCs in their area. So we had someone ask how they could partner with you or reach out to you.
Great. So, in response to that question, in terms of the planning stages of an MLP, the National Center for Medical Legal Partnership is, that is their primary area. They are really great with providing support as you begin bringing together your legal and medical partners and build the MLP from the ground. The network is trying to get a lot more involved in helping to use a public health perspective to take those issues you identify through the MLP and kind of figure out broader legal solutions. And so just wanted to clarify that if you have questions about starting up an MLP, the National Center is probably your best resource for that. And I would love to put you in touch with Ellen Lawton or others at the National Center. And if you'd like to talk about how to kind of incorporate the public health perspective right from the beginning, I'd love to talk about that and would be happy to connect on that. In terms of the network's collaboration with the National Center, we're kind of it's for the past year, it's kind of been a pilot of how do we figure out how to work together most effectively and efficiently to find areas of overlap and that kind of thing, and we'll probably take on a slightly different flavor as we move forward. So I can't quite answer that yet, but would love to connect with anyone who's interested in thinking about that and thinking about that moving forward and get you connected with the region, the network region that's in your office to get specific technical assistance as well.
Thanks, Colleen. The next two questions I have are for you as well. The first one is, can you share any examples of MLP collaborating on either hospital or state and local community health assessments and plans?
So I believe that sometimes MLPs have used the community health needs assessments to inform the topics that they choose to focus on. Those, if you go back to that, those iHelp categories, they look at the community health needs assessment and then can kind of draw from that to determine what some of the specific really prevalent community needs are. I'm not personally aware of the role they've, you know, I think I have heard of that happening. I can check in and try to find some specific examples. There are several MLPs that are really getting much more involved in public health in their communities. There's an MLP in Akron that we've been working on as a part of the Akron, Ohio, that we've been working on with as a part of the collaboration that the MLP attorney there has gotten really involved in community level public health efforts and so probably has played a role in the community health needs assessment. So if somebody had a specific, like wanted a connection with that, I'd be happy to connect you with that attorney to talk about how that, how her role played out in that context.
Awesome. Thanks, Colleen. And I'll just say, if anyone would like to be connected with any of the presenters or attorneys at the network, we'd be happy to make that connection for you. So just reach out to us. For the next question, I'll bump to another presenter, and then we'll come back to you, Colleen, because we have a few more. But the next one is for Russell. The question says, our jurisdiction is trying to start using telemedicine. Is there a resource that you recommend for model policies and procedures for starting a telemedicine behavioral health program?
That's a really good question. I don't really have a resource that serves as a model as for the policy. It's been sort of our finding that the states that act first kind of become the model, and we've seen that in some other areas as well. I'm afraid I can't really give a recommendation for anything specific, but yeah, it's really just hopefully we can share some of the types of things that we're seeing, and maybe like a model will emerge if states have been working together. We have seen a few interstate compacts, so there might be some details that can be uncovered as we sift through our data in a little bit. But no, I don't have anything too specific on that at this point.
Okay, thanks, Russell. The next one is for Sarah. How is the EPSDT applicable to school-based mental health services?
Well, okay. So there's the EPSDT statute and the IDEA, the special education statute, both make it clear that services in an IEP can be covered by Medicaid. So to the extent any mental health services are part of a child's IEP, if the state has set up its administration so that it can happen and is working with the school district, then there's no problem getting that covered. There are also some circumstances where children may be getting services that aren't covered, like they're not being provided by the school district, but a provider, like a peer aide or something, can be accompanying the child to school. When it comes to school services provided, like school counseling services or another services provided by an employee or contractor of the school that aren't covered by an IEP, that can be, there are more barriers to that. For about 20 years, there was a policy in place that the federal Medicaid agency said that services that are quote, provided free of charge to others in the community can't be covered by Medicaid. And that included a lot of services provided in schools. And so schools were not, you know, were not billing for them. They never set up the infrastructure to do it. In 2014, CMS reversed that policy, but because it was in effect for so long, there was, you know, sort of an infrastructure that had grown up that, made it, that placed barriers on it. For example, there might have been a state law or policy or regulation that prohibited coverage of services in schools. And it's funny you ask this question because I, at NHELP, the National Health Law Program, we've been working with the Healthy Schools Campaign and Trust for America's Health with different groups of state government stakeholders who are trying to remove the barriers to billing for some of this kind of care in schools. And so if you're interested in, that whole, you know, in that whole process, you could contact me, but also the Healthy Schools Campaign has a website, and there's a lot of information about it on there. The final thing I'll say is the federal Medicaid agency is very much a booster of school-based health centers, which can sometimes be like a federally qualified health center that's attached to a school. Those can very easily be Medicaid providers and provide mental health services. And if your state is a state with a lot of school-based health centers, then that's usually administratively pretty easy for the state and preferred by the feds.
Great. Thanks, Sarah. The next question, Colleen, I'll come back to you. This one's from Jean. Can you say a little bit more about how the MLPs can assist with that third public health law service of advocacy and building political will?
Great question. So I think a really key part of that service and the importance of involving MLPs is that it's about the words of the message used to try to build political will for a law, but it's also about how the message is delivered and the relationships that are in place and who delivers the message. And by including MLP teams in this process, you can have a broader range of community partners that are able to reach different groups within the community, physicians and the legal services attorney and the patients and clients themselves, and they can deliver messages using their own personal stories and kind of building connections with all different kinds of people within the community. And so I think it's just a really great way to engage broader communities and to engage them more deeply by kind of finding the right person to convey the message and the story that helps people connect to the service or the law that you're working on.
Thanks, Colleen. I still have a few more questions here, but if people have questions, please feel free to keep them coming as we go through these. Another one for you, Colleen. Any advice on fostering collaboration between MLPs and public health law resources at a local level?
So I think what we've seen from the in Chicago, there is a MLP that involves the city's Department of Public Health, and the department was able to be really helpful to the MLP in identifying areas to focus on initially, in which communities to focus the MLP in, and what issue areas to focus on, because the public health department was really strong in pulling together data and then analyzing that data to determine what issues really needed some focused work, and in bringing together community gatherings to inform the development of the MLP. And so the public health department there played a really instrumental role right from the beginning. And so I think that's one way, is to bring in all these partners from the beginning and give them all a role in developing and shaping the MLP. And then the National Center for Medical Legal Partnerships communications person, Kate Marple, is fantastic. And she had an idea for she told me that when she's helping legal and medical partners to come together around some issues that are ripe for advocacy. She suggests that the maybe the legal partner go in and ask the medical partner, what are your three biggest issues that are a barrier to your patients achieving health, your three biggest non-medical issues, and then kind of figuring out which of those they can work together on. And that might be, I think, the same with working with public health law, kind of, and with public health agencies. Try to figure out where those big issues of overlap are, where you're all already working, and then find the opportunity for working together to make the efforts of each group stronger, but kind of making sure that it's something that fits within the priority areas of each of the partners. So, some thoughts.
Sounds good to me. Yeah. Thanks, Colleen. Russell, I'll come back to you. Can you explain what the number of telemedicine laws in a state means for how that state uses telemedicine?
Yeah, sure. It's not totally conclusive because we've seen several different structures when it comes to how states are doing it. Our hypothesis going in was that states with the most need would have the most legislation. They would be the most active. But that's not necessarily what we actually saw once we pulled the laws, because some states do everything with an individual statute. So when you get really granular, you might have an insurance statute, and then you might have a statute that specifically deals with telepsychiatry, and then you have a statute that deals with teledentistry, and then you have 10 more statutes that deal with licensure and provider requirements and all that stuff. But then other states pass these big sweeping provisions that are all encompassed in a telemedicine act or something similar, and they go into all of the specifics all in that single law. So there actually isn't a lot we can tell purely by the number of laws in a specific jurisdiction, but we're hoping that our categorization of the laws will give us a better picture of the types of things that states are doing and how they're moving on this issue.
Sounds good. Thank you. Sarah, I'm going to come back to you with a question. The federal government is allowing states to impose work requirements as a condition of Medicaid eligibility. How does this interact with the social determinants of health?
As people may have heard, the federal government has given states permission through programs called waivers to require some Medicaid beneficiaries to work. This doesn't apply to children, but it does impact children because parents who are caregivers, many of them are going to be subject to this requirement. So the federal government, in some of the approvals of the work requirement programs and in some public remarks, have talked about the idea that work is a social determinant of health. And their position is that requiring people to work or to engage in some other kind of activity similar to work is going to positively impact the social determinants because there is a correlation between working and towards and better health. Now, this, you could argue about the wisdom of this, but it seems to me that this is perhaps a bit of a distortion of what social determinants of health are really all about. And in the particular, it does perhaps reverse the correlation with work and health. A lot of evidence shows that people being healthy enables people to work, and health insurance enables people to work. So that is, they're using the buzzword, but I'm not sure it's really being honored in the actual meaning with those work requirements.
Okay, thanks, Sarah. Do you mind if I stay with you for the next question?
Sure.
I have, what role do managed care organizations play in Medicaid for children, and how can they have an impact on social determinants of health?
Most of Medicaid services are currently delivered by managed care. In a lot of states, Medicaid is almost completely managed care. Something like three-quarters of Medicaid beneficiaries overall are enrolled for at least some of their services in risk-based managed care, which means capitated HMO or PHP type managed care, where there's a restriction on your choice of provider. And in managed care, one of the options that managed care plans is to use reserved savings to cover services that aren't otherwise covered by the Medicaid Act. And some states have taken this authority and asked for additional authority from CMS to really venture out into new areas. One state where they have gotten a lot of publicity and a lot of discussion is Oregon, where they have what they call coordinated care organizations. And one of the things, the textbook example of the way that these managed care plans, these organizations have tried to impact health without using health measures, is to use funding to buy air conditioners for children who have asthma. Obviously, the logic of that is pretty clear. Spend $300 to $500 on a window air conditioner for a child's bedroom, save tens of thousands of dollars in hospitalizations for children with asthma. So they have this leeway and authority to sort of experiment to get services that just don't strictly fit into the clinical mode. And that was a direction that CMS, the Federal Medicaid Agency, was pushing during the previous administration. There isn't as much of a focus on that now, but a lot of these projects continue, and the federal authority is still there in the regulations.
That's interesting. Thank you. Colleen, the next one is for you. We had someone ask, I heard it mentioned about the Lancaster Hospital having a template letter for providers. Would it be possible to get in touch with your partners there? They're developing something similar in their clinic in California.
Sure. So that's actually a story I heard secondhand. I have not worked directly with them, but I think I can find a contact. So if you can send an email address through the chat or something like that, I will connect with you and find a contact for you.
Thanks, Colleen. Yeah, that's a good idea. If anyone needs to be connected with someone in particular, feel free to post that in the questions, and we'll make sure you get connected. The next question is for Sarah again. What lessons are you finding in your three states about how to engage communities and build political will in order to effectuate the MCH changes you're wanting?
Yeah, this is a great question and something that we're continuing to explore. First of all, the innovation of the project is to try to pull in stakeholders who don't directly work on child health, who aren't clinicians or the like. And while everyone who's been approached for this is very interested and enthusiastic about the idea, in reality, everybody's day job keeps them busy. And so some of the less usual suspects have will and interest in participating, but it's difficult for them to find the time to do it. With regard to individuals who are beneficiaries or people who are, potential beneficiaries, our partners have convened, wanted to convene focus groups. And these are groups that are used to working with people who have lower incomes and less flexibility, and having they already are tried and true methods of having these gatherings in the evening or on weekends, and providing a stipend or a babysitter on site, so that people who don't have childcare, don't have money for gas, will be willing and able to come. As far as getting buy-in, the Medicaid agencies have all been interested and wanting to be involved in it. One of the areas that has still to be broached is working with, in the two states that have managed care, working with the managed care plans, and that's sort of the later stage of it. So this is, the work is ongoing in that.
That's interesting. All right, I have one more question. We can finish up with Russell unless someone jumps in with someone else. Russell, can you discuss the potential uses of this type of phase one scan that you were talking about?
Yeah, sure. This is kind of what I was getting at the very end of my presentation, but The idea is that people are interested in lots of specific areas of telemedicine that affect them. So providers are worried about licensure and med mal liability. Facilities are worried about what they have to do to establish a patient-provider relationship, how they credential their staff. I'm interested in mental health care through telemedicine and those types of things. So the idea is that whatever your specific question is, you want to know how telemedicine affects these areas, you can pull that out of our data set and design your own studies. And we have plenty planned already, just the three of us, Rachel, Dawn, and I, but we hope that people will be excited to use our data set and want to collaborate with us or just take it and run with it and design their own studies, using our data set. And then it's also our plan to just keep it continuously updated so that as the laws change and as the conversation grows and the needs of the field expand, we can account for the changes in laws that should happen as a result.
Thanks, Russell. I'm going to turn things back over to Charles just to wrap things up.
Thanks, Melissa, and thank you, everyone, for your participation in today's webinar, and thank you to our panelists for presenting today. I learned a lot, and I know our attendees did as well. So just a few final notes to all of our attendees. You will be receiving an email that will have a video playback of this webinar when it's available, as well as a link to our brief webinar survey. We really value your thoughts about today's webinar and what topics you would be interested in for future webinars. You'll also be receiving an email from ASLME with information on applying for CLE credits for this webinar. And finally, our co-sponsors for today's event, The Network and ASLME, are hosting the 2018 Public Health Law Conference this October in Phoenix, Arizona, which will include the three sessions that we've previewed today featuring Russell, Colleen, and Sarah. So if you enjoyed this webinar, make sure you register for that conference. And that concludes today's webinar. Thank you all for attending and have a great rest of your day.